There goes FERP. That's not FERP, that's Title IX. Sorry. So if I'm using the new mathematical logic to describe something, we use variables to represent the sets of things that we're talking about. So I would say, for example, there exists an x, backwards e, such that x is s and x is p. So these are predicates. So in this case, I'm saying this is the subject and this is the predicate, of which is a predicate, right? But this is the object that I'm supposed to be talking about, but how do I know what it is? Well, I say it exists, but it only exists because it's predicated so this way. So what gives an object its substance, so to speak, is the things that we attribute to it that we call predicates. There's no actual thing there. So it's particles in an arrangement and an action, right? That's what we're talking about as existing. Because in physics, you don't actually have anything that exists over time. It goes in and out of existence. What instead exists is the arrangement, the organization of the thing. So, we're talking about the persistent self. What traditionally we used to think was that I'm a thing. I exist over time. And today, instead, we're aware that all my particles are going in and out of existence. They're arranging themselves into the shape of the cells that make me up. And those are kept in the basic order that they are because of my DNA and the RNA that keep replicating themselves in order to keep that cell somewhat the same as it was. It's not exactly the same, but nonetheless pretty darn close enough that I still recognize myself even though I age and so on. Right? All those things are definitely persistent, but they're kind of an organization that's persisting, not the specifics bottom things that persist. Right? So if you look at the world from a physicist's point of view, what exists? Well, so what we have are multiple levels of discourse. So this really ties in beautifully again with the model-dependent reality idea that we get from Stephen Hawking, right? That there are different ways of talking about things, and that in each of those different ways of talking, we have a vocabulary where there are objects that exist for us so that fluent speakers of a language in that particular environment know exactly what they're talking about. If I go to the supermarket and I ask you, where are the oranges that are on special in their flyer, they can point exactly to the, and then I can buy them. So I know the vocabulary that they use in that place. And that's the same thing when we're talking about people. So if I'm talking about a person, what is a person today? Where's my classics? And I want other items, and one of them is, what is a person? Have I shown you that picture yet? She's the wife of my next brother's stepson. Is that right? Did I get that right? Will Cockrum, his name is. Right? And she married him. And by the way, this was on her wedding. So this was a rather late wedding, depending on how you look. Or is that average today? I don't know. But so this was a photographer that took her wedding pictures. They posed on the beach in Ocean City. And obviously, you can see the little guy is on the way at their wedding. I mean, he's been born already, by the way, and he's over a year old now, by the way. But I asked her permission, could I use this picture for this particular page? She said, oh, it's my favorite picture. And I said, mine too. And she stopped talking to me after that. That was weird. You know, I should not have said, that. That was weird, I suppose. But so this is obviously a person who isn't quite a person yet in the, you know, that general locale. Right? It's kind of funny. I can remember, I can't remember it, but I have a postcard from my mom and dad's wedding, their honeymoon, of the hotel in Ocean City, same place. And my dad drew an arrow to the top window. Did I say, you know, this is where we were staying, you know? And I even have my dad's diary. My dad wrote a diary, you know. Still, when he died and we were going through the house, we found his grass cutting diary. I mean, you know, mow the lawn today, you know, the date, you know, and everything, you know, I set it at half an inch, you know, or, you know, or, you know, or, you know, I mean, he's describing it to the, you know. But at the wedding, you know, this is where they stayed, and, you know, he had, you know, the menu that they ate, you know, after they got to the hotel, and then he wrote, and we retired, you know, with quotations around retired to the bedroom.
He actually wrote a quotation marks around it?
Yes, he did. and so I'm assuming, okay, that's roughly around 9 o'clock. You know, I'm assuming that somewhere around 2 hours later, I was being conceived of in some way or another. So by the next day, with my mom sitting on the beach, and they had bought a camera, and they took a picture of my mom sitting there along the boardwalk, smiling. I figured I was a blastocyst in that particular. Did I say this already? It's obviously a sketch. A sketch. I say this. I'm old enough to repeat myself. So, at what point do you become a person? Well, I stole this. Remember my discussion about plagiarism?
Well, you didn't steal it. You had permission.
Well, actually, I didn't. Oh, the picture, yes, but the definition I stole from two different philosophers, John Rawls, who really is talking about citizens, and Peter Singer, who's really talking about persons. And I've modified it because Peter Singer's definition didn't meet my requirements. But so here's the basics that you have to have in order to be a person. Okay. I can just make it bigger. Oh, she just grew also. So it interacts with other individuals. They consider themselves as individuals. And the type of individual as type of individual each is viewed by each individual as defined by the other individuals. That is, they are individuals but are dependent on one another for their sense of what that means. So it's a social thing. And it's deliberately vague because I could be talking about ants. You know, ants in a colony, do they think of themselves as individuals with one another? We have no clue. I mean, I can't even know what a bat thinks, right? Already discussed that, so how can I imagine what an ant thinks? So do they think of themselves as persons, you know, and everybody has, obviously ants, the movie, made it look like they do, so our kids grow up confused about ants, but actually I don't think ants are persons, but it's up to them. It's not up to me to define whether or not ants are persons or not, from their point of view. But from my point of view, no, I'm not expecting ants to vote, to have some kind of a discussion with me about what persons are, right? Yeah. Right? I'm not going to...
Put their ballots.
You imagine, I can picture now an ant with a great big ID card, you know, on its back. I've been a resident here my whole 3 days. So, it interacts with, it's social. And we define one another as individuals. It's self-reflecting, or, now here's, after the comma is my addition to Peter Singer, because for Peter Singer, it has to be self-reflecting. You mean self-aware, right? Or can become self-aware, self-reflecting, right? And that's important because at the point at which this particular child, in fact, I've seen the pictures of the child, as far as I know, at 1 year old, it's not self-reflecting yet, right? Because that's the program that we have to, number one, be linguistic enough to have a language, to have concepts of self, a name, recognize my name, you know, recognize, you know, the kinds of things that you describe as yourself, and so on. And so if you're a pre-linguistic individual, you don't have language yet, you're not going to be able to do that. So an infant is pre-linguistic, not going to be able to do that, right? So as far as Peter Singer was concerned, you know, you could, if you're going to argue that you can have an abortion, that ought to be legal, and hopefully, you know, it's free and safe, you know, according to the bumper sticker I saw in the parking lot just the other day, right? You know, keep abortion free and safe, as I think was the bumper sticker, right? Well, if you're going to argue for that, and argue that it's okay to kill a fetus because the fetus is not a person, because it doesn't have this capability, right? That's the argument, by the way. It's not a person yet.
Well, right. Not every individual.
Not everybody agrees.
Depending on how old they are, they could have a disability that affects them so that
guess
they're not
what? We don't
like
necessarily
everybody
agree that they're persons either.
Really? That's true.
Yeah.
The logic seems a little screwy.
Well, it is. It's outrageous by some standards. But that's why I put, or can be expected to become. So I'm expecting that child to be born, be fed, nurtured, etc., poop all over, you know, all that stuff, and then eventually go to school and, you know, and become president someday, right? So that fetus has potential to become this. So that's my addition. Peter Singer doesn't have that. Because he actually says, you know, if you're going to argue that a fetus can be aborted, that same argument actually applies to, like, up to 2 years old. So if you have a 2-year-old kid and you hate it, just get rid of it. This is what kept him from going to Germany, by the way. He was supposed to go give a lecture, and they banned him from Germany, Peter Singer. Like, when they hired him at Princeton, there was like riots at Princeton. A riot at Princeton is women standing there with signs. That's a Princeton riot. I've been on campus at Princeton for about 20 minutes, which was long enough for me to buy a t-shirt, a sweatshirt, a couple of pins, you know, a banner, and be absolutely horrified that that was the crappiest bookstore I've ever been in, college campus. But I think that he's just playing a game here, but I don't think he really thinks 2-year-old children can be dumped in the dumpster if you don't want them. He's just trying to make the point that you folks who are arguing that a fetus and be killed are just as bad as if you were arguing, right?
Right.
Keep in mind, Peter Singer thinks pigs have rights.
shouldn't treat pigs the way we do, or chickens.
Well, you would almost have to have that same philosophy if you're going to apply to human life like that, for animals as well.
Exactly. Yeah, he was the one that started the Grade 8 project. You know, that we shouldn't, you know, do experiments and lock other great apes up.
Mm-hmm.
Other great apes do, right? Shouldn't lock them up and treat them. There's some horrible stories of things that happen to those. So that's his, he's a vegan,
mm-hmm.
et cetera. So he's not really recommending that two-year-olds can be killed. He's trying to point out that the argument that says
right.
that feti, more than one fetus, can be killed is horrible. It's a horrible argument. But still, I put this in there.
It's emotional.
Right? Because I don't like the idea. You know, when it gets to abortion, that's one of the things that we'll see in this. Now, of course, as you know, I was raised Roman Catholic, so I understand the church is trying to protect life. And the way you protect life is by respecting it and killing a fetus, etc. Not a way to do that. On the other hand, I'm completely in agreement with the woman that wants to be in charge of her body. I don't think we as a community have a right to tell women what to do with their bodies. But I am confused why women find themselves in the circumstance where they want to kill their child. So there's something in our culture that...
Well, I think that's a pretty loaded thing to say, because you're assuming that a woman has the attitude that she's thinking, I want to go kill my child, and I guarantee you 99% of women aren't thinking that. They're either in a poverty situation or they're in a desperate situation, they're extremely vulnerable, and they're feeling desperate. So, I mean, there's so many arguments about abortion you can make.
And I was clearly loading my
right.
way of saying that.
Exactly. Exactly.
To come from the point of view that, why are you not thinking of it this way?
And right, right, exactly.
But I understand, of course, that that's the case.
And then there's an argument where you could say, is abortion ever going to go away, no matter how many laws we make? And absolutely.
Was it ever?
No.
The answer is no.
And it's never not gone away.
Cain might not have been the third person.
Exactly. Exactly.
I'm laughing, but boy, that would really get a lot of rabbis upset, wouldn't it? Mm.
And do we embrace as a society taking care of all these vulnerable children that are born into our society, or taking blame again to the vulnerable person? There's all kinds of.
Well, and.
Because we don't, as a society, we don't want to take care.
As we were talking about older people that don't have the same capability, I've mentioned my son Christopher that we adopted, right? It's fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. Lots of occasions, I'm not thinking like only of, you know, the day he tried to burn the house down, the day that we went to harvest a Christmas tree, right? And we went to Elmendorf, was open, you know, this is the area you can cut down Christmas trees. I think we had to pay $5 for the thing. I forget, maybe it was free. But so we went to the area. I had all the kids, this should be a fun event, going out and cutting down a Christmas tree in the woods. Right. Mom's back home making dinner or whatever. And I have all the kids, and we're going to go and cut down a Christmas tree. And for some reason, all I remember was Christopher was the one that got out. The girls both stayed in the van, keeping them warm. But we got out, and we looked at some trees in the area, and he picked this tree. And said, okay, are you sure? Yes, okay. So we cut it down. And as soon as we pulled it down, as you pull it from its spot with the other trees, most of the tree seems to disappear because it turns out to be branches from other trees that give it the full look that it has in the woods, right? So as you pull this tree out, you realize, wow, that's the ugliest tree I've ever seen. You know, but that's the one we picked. That's the rules. You know, you can't like keep cutting down trees until you get one that you want. You know, you get that one. So we pull it to the car. And I'm, you know, strapping it up on the roof, you know. And he's, I don't want that tree. That's the one we cut. You can't go back. Well, so here we are, it's getting dark in the woods on Elmendorf, right? Cold, right? And you know, so let's get in the car. We've got to, you know, get home. And he won't get in the car. I try to manhandle him into the car. No, he won't. Runs away, right? You know, I can't leave you here. You know, you could die out here, right? No, but he won't get in the car. So I figure, all right, I'll drive back to the SBs, and ask them to come and help because he's not getting in the van, right? So I get in the van and I start to drive, and what does he do? He runs up and he grabs a hold of the van. So this is how he could be killed, right? So you stop, right? And you get out, and he runs away. Right? You see how this picture, you know, so, you know, he's running, you know, trying to drive, he's hanging on. You know, that's just not working. Finally, of course, I did finally get him into the car. Exhausted, you know, just absolutely frustrated, got him in, and he's crying because he's just absolutely refusing that's not the tree. So I get him home. Well, the next day, that was it. We decided we drove him to Charter North Star and had arranged, this was a drop-off, right? So we brought him in and we dropped him off. You know, we came in. He thought it was just an appointment. But basically, we were leaving him. And once he was there for like 2 weeks, and then from there, they moved him to the one over on Bregal, which is no longer there, I noticed. But it was he was there for 18 months in that facility.
It was a North Star facility?
What was it? Well,
it was called.
Yeah, it's right across from like where the social worker building is. But now it's something else. But he was there, you know, it was one of those where they had 24-hour monitor, you know,
right.
They couldn't wear belts, they couldn't have shoelaces, all that stuff.
They observed.
Right. This is $1,000 a day.
Yeah.
All the you put. $1,000 a day. So, you know, $365 days. You can imagine how much that adds up, plus medicines and so on.
Isn't that called Wheelie's now?
No, that's the school over. He was there too, actually.
His name is just coming back to me. I'm sure
that. Yeah, my wife was absolutely amazing with bureaucracy. In fact, she still is. You know, we've got so many brochures about getting old and living forever, and all the government things, and all that stuff. And she arranged as much possible care for him as possible. Until he was 18, in December, so he signed himself out and left and went to the Covenant House. And within 3 days, they were calling us. He was suicidal. He wanted to kill himself, etc. By the way, he's 35 now.
Wow.
And has been in jail. He's done all these things. Because it's not something you can fix, at least as far as we know. Maybe gene manipulation eventually might help. This, but as it is,
it's resilience factor.
It's like you're trying to install programs into a computer that doesn't have the hardware for it, right? Even like that kind of clock, an analog clock, he cannot make. So if I say, okay, so it's a little after 7:15, he'd have no clue what we're talking about. If it's a digital watch with 7:15, 7:15. Of course, that doesn't mean that he would recognize, okay, so be back here at 7:20. Forget it. That's not going to happen. Right? But he's had jobs, has learned to run the cook, I mean, you know, all kinds of things. Employers have hired him, given him 3 months of training, they figure, okay, he's all ready. They put him, you know, now you do it. And they discover that he fooled them that whole time. He's like a chameleon, one social worker said, right? You know, so you can say things to him, you know, so you're okay with, you know, the circumstance? Yes. You know? And then if this person says, so you're not happy with circumstances? No.
So in hindsight, wouldn't it have been better just to abort him at 6 weeks? If you knew at 6 weeks,
well,
what you know now, wouldn't it have been?
Well, of course, I wasn't in his life at all until 13 months, but his birth mother was in the same shape.
But just hypothetically speaking, if we had the technology.
Now, so here's the issue. You know, did he become self-reflecting? I don't really know.
Even if he is self-reflecting in the state he's in, what?
Well, if he's not self-reflecting, which the screen isn't anymore either.
But as a society, I'm going to totally go way out here. As a society, I work with at-risk youth, by the way, so I can identify with what you're talking about. If we are a society that only lives amongst high-functioning people, you know, how are we as a society when I cannot tell you how much I get back from clients that I work with in your son's case, because it helps me look through a different perspective in the world.
We love him.
You know,
yeah.
So there's so many things you can say about, you know, yeah, exactly. Of course you love him. And I think, you know, as parents, we all have, you know, I mean, we have kids that are challenging and stuff, but do we want to really be a society like that with only high-functioning people? Is there such a thing? Is
yeah,
there even
could,
such a thing?
Could,
you know?
Well, that was the eugenics.
Right, exactly.
But it doesn't
that
even sound like
happened.
He's normal function.
He's within.
But that's your
opinion.
He's within
though. Like 91% IQ.
The way we define high functioning society, no, he can't keep a job. However, what's his reality on? I mean, you can fill up.
And who does he interact with?
Right.
And if you
right.
So I was arguing with someone once. I think she was like working in a prison out in Matsu or something. Roughly 25% of the population. So I don't know if you would agree with this or not, but I would say roughly 25% of the population of our state has fetal alcohol
yes.
spectrum
mm-hmm.
disorder.
Yes, especially in the Native community, Alaska Native community.
So there's some agreement. Now, if officially we don't actually say that, because then we would have to give them medical care. That would be mandatory, and we couldn't afford it. We'd be bankrupt. And actually, with Christopher, it's so frustrating because I think if we had, let me keep close that a little bit, if we had a kind of facility where he would be restricted to. I mean, there are, it seems to me there ought to be the kinds of facilities where it's kind of like the academy on Fort Rich. That strikes me as the kind of thing that he would do well in, right? But the thing is, we also have this advocacy for freedom, which really is the second half of our class tonight. And what's free will? Do we have it, right? And so we want to allow people the maximum freedom, which means we won't put him in a facility where he's restricted from doing what he wants to do, even though I can guarantee if you give him money, like, so he comes back from a fish processing plant in one of the towns where he's continually worked for the one company. In fact, he's even gotten like promoted to the point where he's like the one observing the line, making sure everybody's doing the job correctly. He can do that. Right? He comes back to Anchorage with $600 in his pocket,
goes into Coots or whatever bar it was, I don't know, and he says, drinks on me, and he spent it all. And then has no money for rent or any, you know, just like, he does have Bill, is the conservator. We used to be, but we realized we had no control over his money, whereas the state conservator actually does, so we said, you guys take that. I remember the judge being very depressed with us, but we thought we were making the right decision. I'm sure we made the right decision, at least as far as we were concerned. So the conservator can, like, harvest his money and then pay his bills, to some extent. But Chris, you give Chris money, he gives it to you if you ask for it. He doesn't have any sense of... So if we had some kind of arrangement where we could put people that needed structure and limits, that would be ideal for him. And hundreds, thousands of other... I mean, how many felt for the guy who's protesting Beans Cafe last week? Did you see that?
I didn't hear about that.
Did you see? He owns acres of property just across the street from Beans and St. Francis Shelter. And he's owned it for like 30 years. And he put up a great big sign, the party's over as of October 1st, get out. He had piles of all these plastic bottles, alcohol bottles.
Meaning people were camping on, homeless people were on his property camping or Beans Cafe?
Well, he has a fence there, but it's right across the street.
Right.
I work like right across from the rescue mission, like on Twitter.
Uh-huh.
And I have to clean up bum messes on a regular basis. And we're not even like right across the street. It's like down the street. So it's like, I'm not saying all of them, obviously not all of them are responsible, but when you have a kind of population, there's a certain percentage of them that just do not care and that will leave garbage and stuff everywhere.
There was one scene where one of the women came across and looked at the bottles that he had piled, and they were piled up like this deep. And she came over and looked at them and said, some of these are not ours.
Because you can tell which one.
Shoot, where's the change, W? Where's search? Is there a search anywhere? I don't see menu. Oh, here's search. Nope, I don't see it.
Was it on their Facebook page?
Well, it was on in the Daily News. I get the paper. I don't know if you know it, but the Anchorage Dispatch News prints on paper, and you can have it delivered to your door every morning except Saturday. And you, like, it comes in like an orange wrapper. And sorry, I realize only two or three other people in the world read the paper. And even Sunday, you can get the New York Times. So it's like a bundle of paper. It'd be great if you had a fireplace. In any case, it was a big picture. He and some of his relatives were all standing there protesting Beans. His basic argument was that you're enabling these folks and making the problem worse. And so let me get back to my definition, because I mean, we could argue about this until the cows come home and as far as I know, the reason we say that is because the cows never come home. Unless you have a trombone. So, apart from defining what a person is, what isn't a person? So this is my summary of 8 major topics that we argue about with regard to persons. I don't have the issue of a corporation in here. How many of you feel like a corporation should not be a legal person? Agreement? Now, I have a lot of friends that are like, why are corporations persons?
Because they're made up of people.
Duh. History. You know, when we look at business history and the invention of the corporation and how the legal protections of a person are all what really make a corporation possible, it seems like this should not be an issue, right? These are people and a corporation isn't, so we ought to be able to sue them and say, well, you can actually, because of that definition. But when you get right down to it, notice my definition is perfectly adequate for including corporations as individuals, as persons, right? Because they engage, they discuss, they're self-reflecting. CEO and you know, all the people sit around and they discuss what should be.
However, their purpose is purely profit.
Absolutely,
capitalism
absolutely.
Has nothing to do with humanity. So
and
that's
wonderful human beings like President Trump,
right.
Clearly not concerned with just pure profit. Maybe. No?
That's one of those things, but they're very structured. They're about profit, so it's not a good thing
it's
or bad thing, it just is.
It isn't going to be legally that easy. It's not like you could just say, okay, if you're a person, and so they say, a human being. Well, guess what? A lot of human beings are not persons. A fetus. It's clearly a human being. But guess what? If it's perfectly legal for you to kill it. So here's some of the things that so euthanization, right? At what point, so if I'm trying to say that we would not kill a person, to euthanize someone, we have to stop thinking of them as a person. And at what point, if you agree that euthanization is okay,